Alrighty, I don't think we see anybody else coming in, so we'll go ahead and get started. Welcome, everybody. My name is Matthew. I'm the Public Services Librarian here at the Albert Lee Public Library, and thanks for coming to November's Lunch and Learn. I'm really pleased to introduce author and retired professor Dean Ulland, who is going to be talking about his book, We Must All Be Ready to Sacrifice, and the effects of World War I on Fribourne County, southern Minnesota, and I think some specifically Albert Lee as well, too.
Yes, as a matter of fact.
So. All right. Well, I will hand it over to him. Thank you.
Okay, thanks. I always try when I do these to try and customize a little bit for the community that I'm in. And so I went through. I enjoy doing that. And I came through and I added a few little tidbits specific to Albert Lee. As he said, I'm a retired, used to teach at Riverland, taught history and political science for quite a few years. I live, along with my lovely wife, Harriet, in the Corning area. I don't know if you know where Corning is. It's kind of God's country in far eastern Fribourne or far western Moore County. We live kind of on the county line. So that's where I come from. I've enjoyed teaching and talking and writing and thinking and researching World War I for really a big part of my life. I'll talk about that a little bit in just a moment. I would like to go back for a minute. We must all be ready to sacrifice. The title of the book actually comes from the Fribourne County Standard, May 3rd, 1917. This is the top half of the article. And it says, women civil auxiliary gets a splendid start. If we go one to the bottom part of the article and take a look at the arrow, it says, as part of the address that this lady, I believe Mrs. The lady who gave the address in giving her speech said that we must all be ready to sacrifice sacrifice our selfish pleasures, work together to achieve good results in this war effort. And when I saw that sentence, we must all be ready to sacrifice, it jumped out at me. That's got to be the title of the book. It was, after all, this is what I'm trying to drive at. We're not talking about World War I simply from a perspective of history from the top down. We're not we'll maybe mention a little bit, but I've kind of lost my interest in what kaisers and czars and foreign ministers want to have you did. I'm more interested in how it affected us, our ancestors, folks who lived in Fribourne or Moore County or in Blooming Prairie or wherever it might be. That seems to be the way that I like to approach my researching in World War I these days. People ask me how I got this far. Why do I find it so appealing? And who knows why we generate our interest. But I will say that on the left here is a 10-volume history of the Great War, of the World War, that was my great-grandpa Ulland's. And when he died, my dad came into those books, and they're now on my shelf. I'm the steward of those books for my generation. And I remember as a student, when I lived at home in junior high and high school, picking those off the shelves and looking through what's this all about? That's probably some of it. The other part, one of my grandmothers grew up in England, and she had vivid memories of the night in January of 1916 when a Zeppelin flew over and dropped bombs within hearing and seeing of where she was. And so that also kind of intrigued me, and so maybe that's how I've gotten my interest. One point I should make before we start, this gentleman, a man called Norman Angell, in his day a very, very popular and well-respected thinker in the area of international relations, foreign affairs, believed that there couldn't ever be another war like the war that was about to happen, because there was so many economic and political and social ties amongst all these great nations. You simply couldn't have a war. His title comes from the idea that he thought it was an illusion that nations gained from wars of aggression, confrontation, militarism. Boy, was he wrong. But nevertheless, that was a very, very strong line of thinking amongst folks who did think about those things of just a few years before the war broke out. Okay. So this is the war broke out because of an assassination in the Bosnian town of Sarajevo, part of the Austro-Hungarian Empire, one of three great empires in Europe, or four really, in 1914. Austria-Hungary were run by an impossibly old man who wasn't, as this saying goes, you know, he wasn't, all his cards weren't being played at the time. He was pretty old, and he had no business having the amount of power that he did, but that was part of the problems and what caused all of this to break out. You can see it's called the Polyglot Empire. All sorts of languages, religions, cultures try to be jammed into one empire, and hopefully everybody's going to get along. And that didn't work out. Here is Bosnia and Sarajevo. Harriet and I took a trip there a few years ago, just before COVID broke out. I like to be able to see the places I write about. But at the far right here, you would notice where it says museum. There's the Archduke, the assassination that occurred here. The Archduke drove down the street and his chauffeur took a right. He took a wrong turn there. And to the amazement of his assassin, this young Serbian terrorist who had been smuggled into Bosnia, is sitting in this was a coffee shop at the time. To his amazement, he thought he'd missed his target. He finds his target from literally from me to the wall in front of him. So he walked out the door and shot him. That assassination, that murder, we actually with this gun, we were in, that's the museum, we were in there that day. That's the depiction in a newspaper. But when the Archduke was assassinated, it set in motion this long, complicated set of affairs that we now know as the Great War. When it was done, probably 20 million people had been killed, 15 to 20 million. The wreckage of property and lives is impossible to calculate. It was simply a dreadful event. Here is the Emperor Franz Joseph had his summer home at a place called Bad Ischl. It was there that he signed a document which set the Austrians into war with the Serbians. The Serbians had, for a variety of reasons that we're not going to talk about today, it's too much, but the Serbs had sent this terrorist into Bosnia to kill the heir to the throne, and he'd succeeded, so that meant that the Austrians are going to go to war with the Serbs. So the best way that I can explain this is to show a political cartoon of the day from a Brooklyn newspaper. And it's pretty simple here. Think of these folks as dominoes. The Serbs started it all, so the Austrians behind the Serbs are going to punish the Serbs. The Russians are saying, no, you don't, because the Serbs are our little Slavic Orthodox brothers, and you don't want to be mean to them. And behind them are the Germans saying to the Russians, if you're going to pick on the Austrians, we're going to go to war with you. And then France and England bringing up the rear. So pretty soon, from June 28th, 1914, until early August, a whole bunch of feudal diplomacy. The cables are whizzing between capitals, and nobody's doing anything really constructive to try and stop this coming conflagration. The British foreign minister, a man called Grey, said famously, the lamps are going out all over Europe, and they will not be relit in our lifetime. He could see what was coming, and sadly enough, he was probably right. So by August 1914, Europe is at war. This is a German war plan, and I'm just kind of giving you a primer on what happened. It's called the Schlieffen Plan, and it didn't work. The Belgians fought much harder than the Germans thought they would as the Germans were invaded Belgium here. The German lines never got around Paris the way that this theoretical map looks. Here's Paris. The Germans were stopped here along the River Marne. The River Marne. The Germans then proceeded, and the British and the French, it was called the Race to the Sea, the Germans headed back north, digging trenches as they went. And on the other, on the west side of the German line of trenches, the British and the French dug lines of trenches. So if you were to take a look at this line from 1914 and compare it to the one in 1918, you're not going to see much difference. These folks had fought this trench warfare, little movement back and forth, and millions upon millions of young men killed in 4 years for virtually no territory, very, very little territory. So by by then, America is at war. And so we want to talk about this and learn about it. How did it affect the United States? How did it affect us? I know I don't look it, but I'm old enough to remember World War I veterans, including one of my grandfathers. I was being a little silly there. But so I think for many of the folks here, you probably can remember people who were in that war and people who participated in some way. And that, so that's kind of what I'm looking at. You might think it's odd. I do. And I'm sure that folks in 1917, when America went to war, thought it was odd to think that, you know, today I'm farming with Dad, and tomorrow these people want me to go off to war for something that happened 5,072 miles from my house. Now, that's a Google number, so we know it's right. 5,000 miles from Albert Lee to Sarajevo. And you can imagine, and people thinking, what the heck? This obscure place means that all of these dreadful things are happening and I'm going to be expected to cooperate and participate. But that is exactly what happened. So what about the United States as we get to get into the war? First of all, the policy was neutrality. Woodrow Wilson was president, a very firm believer in avoiding war. He was a professor, and that's not maybe the best thing to be if you're president, but he was very much idealistic in terms of his foreign policy. He didn't think that wars between empires were something that America should participate in. Also, his Secretary of State, William Jennings Bryan, at the time, an orator of very probably... after Woodrow Wilson, William Jennings Bryan was the most, perhaps not popular, but the most prominent American. He was very, very well known. He'd been in the American public sphere for, by 1914 or 15, for a generation about. So he was a pacifist. So America was opposed to war on those grounds. Americans always have an attitude, and I think you can even see that today, of avoiding foreign entanglements. It's impossible to do, but we like to, sometimes we like to try. We're, every nation is part of the world, and you can't, I guess my professorial tie, you know, part's coming out, but it doesn't seem to work. The other thing Americans like to do, of course, is trade. We were happy to sell the warring people all the stuff they could buy. In fact, the Minnesota State Fair in 1914, one of its themes was flour barrels, not gun barrels. In other words, we'd like to sell you, you know, if you got the money, we're here with the stuff. And America, by the way, got into pretty serious squabbles with the British, because the British, of course, with a powerful navy, immediately blockaded the Germans, and so we couldn't sell to the Germans. It made some people angry. Another thing that we can see very clearly in our area, and which I think is very interesting, is some ethnic groups in Minnesota or in the country itself didn't want to fight the Germans. We can all imagine and know of German communities in our area, Minnesota River Valley, for example, from Mankato up the Minnesota River on the prairie, many towns with strong German ties. And you remember in 1914 or 15, whatever year you want to pick, those folks were either immigrants or first generation, or many of them were. So they had close ties. We'll see in a minute how close those ties actually were. So there were 400 in Minnesota, 400 schools being taught in the German language. And of course, Irish Americans, we here in Fribourne County, we have Newry Township, a very strong Irish community, although don't want to draw any conclusions from that, but the fact is that lots of Irish didn't have any reason to love the British and want to fight a war on their side. Although I don't, certainly not saying that about Newry Township, because there were, I could show you a number of them who fought and died in that war. So at any rate, those are some of the reasons why Americans wanted to stay out. We stayed out even in 1915, when many Americans were killed on the ship Lusitania off the coast of southern Ireland. Americans got pretty bellicose and belligerent at the time, and William Jennings Bryan was nervous about that. He thought it was too warlike, and he quit. It violated his principles, and replaced by a fellow called Robert Lansing. Robert Lansing strikes me as more of a typical Secretary of State in those days, sort of Eastern, Ivy League, striped pants, if you get the thing I'm talking about, rather than the Midwesterner Bryan. But Lansing did not have the attitude of a William Jennings Bryan. Nevertheless, Wilson kept America out of war. He ran his campaign in 1916 on the theme of peace in America. He's kept us out of war. I must tell you that by November 1916, Wilson probably had a pretty good idea this wasn't going to last, but he tried. So by 1917, the Germans are desperate. They've been blockaded. There is in the richest country in Europe in 1914, by 1917, people are literally dying of malnutrition. It got so bad that amongst the competing partners, the Austrians and the Germans, Austrians were stealing German food. It was that desperate. And so the Germans took desperate measures, and they thought their strategy was, if we can sink all the ships headed to Britain, we can knock Britain out of the war, and America will, by the time we've sunk these ships, America will never have gotten time to get its act together and get in the war. And so the Germans, with this turnip winter, turned loose their submarines, which were numerous and very, very lethal, very lethal. And they did sink millions of tons of cargo bound for the British Isles. Food, Britain couldn't come close to feeding itself, other things. And so it was a pretty desperate situation for a while, but when the Germans started sinking American-flagged vessels, no American president can avoid war when that happens. That's an act of war. Wilson had no choice then but to go to war. The Germans are sort of, you get the idea, they're whistling past the graveyard a little bit. You know, well, first of all, we're going to sink the ships. But if that doesn't work, Americans come to war. Americans can't fight anyway. And so, all those sorts of wishful thinking went into the Germans' wild gamble of sinking British, sinking ships bound for the British Isles. By the way, that's when you've all heard of convoy system, especially in World War II. That's when that system was developed of convoys, and they were able to protect shipping, and the strategy never worked anyway. Another thing that made it easy for Wilson and the American administration to go to war was this. This fellow Zimmerman, the German foreign secretary, sent a telegram to Mexico, to the Mexican government, inviting them to attack the United States from the south. And then when the war was over, and of course Germany's going to win, according to his wishful thinking, then Mexico would get back all the territory that it had lost in the Mexican-American War in the 1840s. You can imagine when the news of that broke in American newspapers, Americans were mightily ticked off, and it made it much easier for the war to occur. So, April 2nd, 1917, the United States, Wilson asked for a declaration of war by the 6th. Both the House and the Senate had granted his wish and had declared war. So that's who gets us sort of the essence of the book is some questions. How did the United States, with a very small standing army and military, procure and train and house and feed and ship a multi-million person fighting force? How are you going to pay for the war? How are we going to get all the folks on the home front on the same page? What are we going to do with people who oppose it? And then briefly at the end, what else was happening at the end of the war? We had the influenza epidemic in northern Minnesota, some dreadful fires which killed hundreds of Minnesotans. So these are all sorts of things that happen to be taken into account. This diverse American population, we need to have people support the war. And so propaganda, the Committee on Public Information, CPI, which is really a propaganda arm of the federal government, is created, that sort of thing. What happens to people who don't support it? We'll see a little bit of that as well. This is just a photograph of or a artist rendering of Wilson asking for the declaration and the joint sense of session of Congress. First thing we've got to do is raise an army. There are 18 nations, I think it is, with bigger armies than the United States in 1917. First thing to do then is to federalize the National Guard, which Wilson did. That's Company G, very early on, April 1917, leaving for Camp Cody, New Mexico, where they'll be trained. Some of the Guard in Minnesota, as well as other parts of the country, had some experience of military combat because they'd been involved chasing Pancho Villa around Mexico in 1916 with General Pershing. And so there was some expertise there, although pretty limited. Very famous in Austin, the VFW post is named after this young man, Olaf B. Dahm, who was tragically killed there. I think the first Moore County resident who was killed in the war. He was killed at Camp Cody in a grenade exercise. He was a lieutenant involved in training, and somehow a grenade got loose and exploded and took his life. Not nearly enough guards, not nearly enough people volunteering. So by May 1917, the Selective Service. We'll talk about this in a little bit of detail because it just gets to the heart of what's happening here. Freeborn County, Albert Lea, or Glenville, Hayward, or Myrtle, or Corning, or wherever you might want to be. Selective Service Act, every eligible man, that is every person from age 21 to 30, had to sign up the same day, June 5th, 1917. I was looking at the next one, June 19. There was another one a year later for those people who had just turned 21, and there was still one more in September of that year, which expanded it to age 45. Went from 18 to 45. They really expanded it. So that's where you see you can go through the records and find drafts or registrations of a father and son or a nephew and uncle the same day. America was pretty nervous by then. This is a picture of the Secretary of State, Newton Baker, drawing from a fishbowl numbers. We have to all understand that everyone registered, but the country wasn't remotely ready to handle any volume of trainees, of draftees. And so the numbers they were drawing were the order in which people were called up. Sometimes if you had a bad number, you'd get called up in the summer of 1917. Sometimes if you had a lucky number, it might not be till September of 1918. Just the luck of the draw and a lottery. I will say that the United States was very, very, in the Selective Service Act, very, very cognizant of the the Civil War experience. Because you may remember that in the Civil War, people could pay for a substitute, buy their way out, and lots of corruption, that sort of thing. This was not to be that way. Everybody was supposed to be playing on a level playing field. Whatever your circumstance of birth or wealth or anything like that. And they were pretty good about that, and probably helped. This is just an example of from a Moore County paper. You can see the number next to each person's call-up list, on the call-up list. So that's the number in which that those numbers had been drawn by the folks in Washington. There were as many numbers as there were the most people in America in any given precinct. So it was in the 10,000s, something like that. But every person who registered got an individual number, and there was a way that they were called up then. Here's the Freeborn County Standard. Thousands, another headline. This is September 1917. Young men had been called up, and they're, escorted to the train, and sort of a lot of hearty, celebration isn't the right word, but gestures of support for the people who, certainly not a celebration, but for the people who are being asked to go. Now I'm going to show you three specific draft registration cards because I want you to, show you three kind of unique situations. This one of them, it's going to melt your heart, I think. It does mine. But this young man is a Blooming Prairie resident, but the long reach of the draft, he is signing up. He's working in Canada. He signs up in the city of Saskatoon. So just because you weren't at home at the time of the registration was no excuse. I found one other specific to Freeborn County. He was working in Saskatchewan, but he came home and signed up that day for the draft. So the draft had a very long reach. There were no excuses. If you were in a wheelchair, you better find somebody to wheel you to the precinct if you were that age. It's not to say you're going to be drafted, but you must register. Every person remotely able to. The only way you didn't register is if you're already in the Army or in one of the armed forces. And there were a couple of other sort of narrow exceptions, but very very narrow, and almost everyone had to register. This one is the saddest one that I've ever seen. This is from a young man in the Dexter area, 10 miles or so east of Austin. If you'll notice, he's a naturalized citizen. He's born in Pomerania. He's a German, born in Germany. And the bottom, where it says, do you claim exemption from the draft? He said yes. Why does he claim exemption? Because if he goes, he might be fighting his brothers who didn't immigrate to America. Now, to me, that's sort of the epitome of the sadness and stupidity and futility of war when you've got this sort of situation. And so I like to show that particular certificate. I've read many other ones in our local counties. And I'm not saying there weren't other people like that, but I have never found another one exactly like that in our locality. Just to end, epilogue to his story, he did get drafted. They denied him the exemption, but his number was good enough that he didn't get called up until very late in the process and was never shipped off to war. He was fortunate. For some reason, that makes me feel good. But at any rate, the third one is from Freeborn County. I'm going to spend a little time with this fellow. I don't know him, know anything about his family other than what I read in books and in newspapers. But he's from Nunda Township, Twin Lakes area, natural born citizen. And you'll note that he claims exemption because he's needed at home. He's a farm boy. And that's repeated over here on the second page. He's needed at home. He didn't want to go. He thought he should be granted an exemption. And by the way, exemptions like that weren't decided at the county level. They sent them off to a district draft board and a regional draft board in Mankato. So there's more anonymity. There wouldn't be claims of favoritism. Mr. Narveson's request was denied. And what happens to Mr. Narveson, and this is my example, this is Veterans Day, the very best of a citizen soldier. Saying that I don't know him, it's not a family or anything like that, but the year after the war ended, November of 1919, the very first American Legion Convention was held in Minneapolis. That day, the French military attaché journeyed to Minneapolis, and this young man who wanted to stay home and put up the hay and milk the cows in 1917 turns out to be a great hero. He's awarded the Croix de Guerre, a very prestigious French military award given to non-French soldiers for kind of service to France, and so to get this is a pretty remarkable thing. And just read the citation. He was separated from his company. They demolished a machine gun nest to reduce to second hostile position, continued to advance, refused to be evacuated despite wounds and being gassed. Pretty remarkable story, isn't it, for a young man. Freeborn County wanted nothing more than to stay home and farm. And so that always strikes me as being an important thing to remember, especially when we're at a holiday like Veterans Day. I'm patting myself on the back a little bit here. Sorry, but I am. When I research these sorts of things, I came across a list of notable people who have received the Croix de Guerre. By the way, he also received a Distinguished Service Cross from the United States. He had other medals. So, and when I found this list, he wasn't on it. And it kind of irked me because I thought, who is this person to decide who's notable and who isn't? Is the sacrifice you make worth more if somebody recognizes your name? I don't think so. And so we have a grandson who's wise in doing these sorts of things. We edited the Wikipedia entry, And these days, if you went on this site, you would see Sergeant Palmer Narveson on it. It was not on there before. And we're not making it up. We left the footnote, and if you were to go to that site and go down and click on that footnote, it would take you immediately to the article in the Freeborn County Standard, which tells about this. So at any rate, that's my little something I did for good or bad. But you'll notice that he's in pretty good company. There's George Patton, Douglas MacArthur, Eddie Rickenbacker, George Marshall, and Palmer Narveson. So there you go. Enough was enough. Camp Dodge was the destination of many Americans. It was a pretty raw place just being built. Soldiers trained there. They went to another place called Camp Upton on Long Island, or many of them did. And Camp Dodge was not the only place they went, but one of the main places for people in our particular area. You know who the very first person to arrive at Camp Dodge was? Moore County resident, and I know you've heard of, his name was Jay Hormel. Jay Hormel didn't want to take the train with everybody else, and so I think he motored down there or something. Jay Hormel, I'm going off the track here, but was very skilled, and many Americans owed a lot to him for his skill in logistics and getting meat and food in good condition to the people in France. So he did do really great service that way. 60, at least by my count, there may be other numbers, but they would be within two or three of this. 60 men from Freeborn County made the supreme sacrifice. About half died of influenza or other related diseases or some accident of some sort. If you read the accounts of the people that died, they'll call it all sorts of different names, but it's a giveaway when their death is in September or October or November or something of 1918. You know that it's related to influenza. In America as a whole, 65% of the soldiers who went and didn't come back or didn't come back alive died of influenza or a related disease. More than half or less than half died of combat-related injuries. And there were about 120,000 American soldiers who went and did not come back alive. Moore County, 65 died, and about 35 of influenza or accident or something like that. So Freeborn and Moore County in many ways through the course of our histories are kind of mirror images of one another, very similar populations and that sort of thing. I'm going to mention a young man from, I believe, the Hayward area. Certainly is a Hayward area name. But first Americans didn't fight until until May 1918, a place called Cantigny. The battle accounts will say low casualties, but 308, is that low? But nevertheless, for World War I, that was pretty low. They proved themselves to be good fighters. General Pershing then began feeding more men into the troop. The person I'm talking about is a man called John Friedenland. John Friedenland started fighting at Cantigny, and he fought, the article says, continuously until July 21st at Soissons, where he was killed. So that means if he fought continuously that he would have fought here at Belle of Wood. This is Belle of Wood in 2015. Anybody here from the Marines by chance? Belle of Wood kind of rings the bell, doesn't it? Okay. Harriet and I have a very good friend whose grandpa was at Belle of Wood. And they talk about this wheat field, and it was about the same time of the year. It would have had to have looked roughly like this. And they talk about the American soldiers who were harvested in the field, meaning this was a joint Marine Army operation, but they frontal assault. And Harriet and I have walked through Belleau Wood, and you can still see the old machine gun emplacements. You can even see all bits and pieces of old weapons in there, 100 and some years later. But that's Belleau Wood, the first sort of the baptism of by fire of Americans. The Germans took to calling U.S. Marines the Teufelhunden, the devil dogs. It's where John Pershing, General Blackjack Pershing, said, the most dangerous thing in the world is the United States Marine with his rifle. This is where the Marines got a big chunk of their well-deserved reputation. Oops. That's what Belleau Wood looked like in 1918, in June. A hellscape. Oh, Harriet and I should back up and be, in all honesty, Harriet and I and another couple flew to Paris in 2015 and rented a car, and we spent a week driving around World War I battlefields, and we actually engaged an individual who lived in the neighborhood of Belleau Wood, who had permission to walk across this land, and gave us a tour, and it was a real eye-opener. Even to 100 years later, if you walk through there, you see evidence of that battle. It was hell. There's no other way of describing it. Ultimately, the United States prevailed and drove the Germans back. But wow! And some of our ancestors were there. Back up one more. Be nice. Here we go. This is a map that I like using maps when I teach. But this is Belleau Wood. By the way, the American cemetery is here too. If you ever get a chance, it's a sobering place to visit. I didn't put a slide on, but the reason Belleau Wood was so important is its proximity to this. It's called the Paris-Metz Road. The Germans were driving south in spring of 1918, starting in March 21st, the Kaiser's battle, and had they been able to seize this road, the road to Paris would have been open to the German army. And so American fighting here, extremely, extremely important. We visited this village of Lucy Bocage and the village of Boresch the days we were there, and they're very charming, old-looking French villages. They look like they've been there for centuries. They haven't been. Lucy Bocage and Boresch in the spring of 1918 were turned into rubble and completely rebuilt, but rebuilt in such a way as, for us non-experts, it looks as though they would be pretty fresh. Here's another. By the summer of 1918, whatever newspaper you pick from any community, you're going to start seeing lots and lots of dead folks. I'd like to, final battle was at Meuse-Argonne, and I've consumed way too much time talking about this. I would like to, by the way, this is a shell art from the Meuse-Argonne. It's just up the street at the Historical Society. If you're ever there sometime, you take a look at it. It's quite an elaborate piece of artwork that somebody did. What about home? How do we get all this work done and all of that sort of thing? First of all, we rely heavily on women. We rely on other folks. I'd like to point something out here. This is a scene that I just put this picture up to indicate the labor that it took to harvest a crop of oats. The other reason I put it up, remember that all the people you see here, there are still other people out there working. Somebody's got to be out picking up bundles, and somebody's got to be operating all of this. And the thought when I show this picture to folks is that these are two are young women who probably wouldn't have been doing that in normal times. But again, probably, and no one knows for sure. That happens to be a photo from One of my relatives in far east, in the Corning area, in Nuri Township. But I have the photo. Lots of things to do. We have to sell bonds. We have to finance this war. And so bonds were sold, and the problem wasn't so much selling the bonds. It's what about the folks who didn't want to buy the bonds? And they were treated mercilessly. If you didn't conform during the war, and this is the downside when we talk about the noble sacrifices, and they were, but we're kind of fighting for freedom, right? But you don't really want to exercise your freedom too loudly in 1917 or 18, or you might find yourself in a lot of trouble. The folks in Steele County, a man called Thomas Cashman, pioneered a way to figure out how much everybody could afford to buy of bonds. And they actually published that in the newsletter of the 9th Federal Reserve District. That was a district, I assume it's still the 9th, I'm not sure. But at any rate, it became went into widespread use. You'd take people's personal property taxes and their real estate taxes and knowledge that bankers had of them, and you would decide, you, sir, you must buy X dollars worth of bonds. And you just want to say, okay, I'll buy them. You don't want to say no, because they'll make your life miserable if you don't. In fact, there was a man in Rose Creek near Austin who didn't want to buy a bond, and his punishment was to be shunned. He'd walk around town, no one would speak to him. And finally, the account says, finally, he broke down and did his patriotic duty, and then once again, he was a man among men. I mean, this is pretty rough stuff. Here in Fremont County, a man called John Rubel developed a way of raising money for the Red Cross by having, his idea was, we have local creameries set off a chunk of your milk check or your cream check every, you know, weekly or monthly, whenever you got it, and send that to the Red Cross. A really noble idea. There were 19 creameries in Fremont County in 1918, plus the ones around the fringes. So you can assume that there's a pretty good chunk of money going to the Red Cross. The problem was, if you didn't want to do it, then there would be a committee who would go, as the account reads, would go and try and convince you to participate. And if you still said no, then another committee came. And apparently they had no sense of humor at all. And when they were done, you would participate. It was they played really rough. I don't think they beat people up or anything, but it's pretty hard to stand against a committee of your neighbors and say, you know, all of you, you know, we're all giving some and you won't. You know, it's pretty hard to say no. The Red Cross... one of the nice things, if you ever want to do a history paper, a graduate seminar, or something like that, Red Cross is a good source because they were meticulous in their record keeping. They could tell you exactly, I think, how many skeins of yarn they used. I mean, down to the last foot of it almost. They really kept meticulous records of hospital gowns and surgical dressings and all the things that they made. The YMCA. The Four Minute Men were folks, and there was a man here in Albert Lee who won an award for the Four Minute Men were the folks who would jump on the stage at the theater and give a pitch by Liberty Bonds because it took 4 minutes to change the reels. And so they had a captive audience for 4 minutes. And then they would, the Committee on Public Information would send these scripts out, and, you know, a good pitch man would, you know, who knows how much. How much you could get. Help on the farm. There's sort of certain amounts of humor in this because with young men off to war, there's a drastic labor shortage in the community. There was a committee meeting on this in Owatonna, written up in one of the Owatonna papers, and there was one of the leaders in Steele County was a Blooming Prairie banker named Sam Rask. And Mr. Rask went there and said, you know, us town folks, we can organize groups of people to go out and help on the farm, help with this harvest. We got to get the harvest in. We're not going to do it for free, don't misunderstand, but we can organize this. And one of the farmers at the meeting, and I don't think he meant it to be funny or sarcastic or anything, but it comes off that way. He said, well, how much good are these city guys going to do anyway? You know, it's sort of, it makes you smile. You have to find a reason to smile once in a while. And that's one that I enjoy. There was a fundraiser for the YMCA in Rose Creek. His name is Father Gminder. Really persistent. You had to be really good to be one of these folks and have a thick skin. There was a person in Rose Creek who wouldn't buy. And I believe he owned a tavern or some such thing. And one day as the priest was going to get on the train, he noticed some freight, and there was a barrel of beer destined for this tavern and for the guy that wouldn't participate. And he ordered the station master to not deliver that beer till the guy came across with his donation. That's those sorts of, and by the way, he got his donation. Pretty serious business when someone keeps your beer. But I'm not trying to be funny, but nevertheless, here's the other big issue. Public Safety Commission. I have an original report that was written in at the very end of the war by the general or by the people in charge of the commission. One of my relatives was on the local, one of the local, not on the state commission, but on the local level. Each township had commission auxiliaries. At any rate, the commission was created by the Minnesota legislature, dictatorial powers. Minnesota was run effectively by a dictatorship in 1917 and 18. The legislature willingly gave up the powers. The governor was an ex officio member of this commission, became in many ways kind of the dictator of Minnesota. His name is J.A.A. Bernquist. The nonpartisan league was thought to be, by some people, rather ambivalent in its support for the war. The nonpartisan league was sort of radical farmers who were pretty angry. It was started in North Dakota. I could do a whole hour on the nonpartisan league, but they were questionable. I'm trying to figure out a way to say this in a brief way, but in May of 18, there was a primary for a Republican primary for governor. Two candidates, J.A.A. Bernquist, the sitting Republican governor, Charles Lindbergh, Charles Lindbergh, father of the famous aviator. He was a congressman from 6th Minnesota, Minnesota 6th, very, very strongly opposed to the war and supported by the nonpartisan league. That created many, many incidents, conflicts across the state when Lindbergh would appear and law enforcement or whatever would try and shut the thing down because it's anti-war and on and on. It's pretty interesting. There's a very good book written by a professor called Bruce Larson that deals a lot with it. There were vigilantes who painted yellow stripes on barns, yellow stripes on cows and horses, picked on people, were nasty. If you didn't conform, there were people who were going to go out of their way to make your lives miserable. Here in Albert Lea, a chapter of what's called the American Protective League, which is a spooky group, they were semi-blessed by the federal government, and effectively they're vigilantes. They would try to get jobs in factories where they would kind of sniff out anti-war people and that sort of thing. We know that there was a committee of them here in Albert Lea, but as you can imagine, probably not many records about it. But it is written up, and there's a very big book on it I have called The Web, which wrote about it and that sort of thing. So you can learn a little bit about that. What I'm trying to get at is the extremism. This is a pretty interesting one, and I realize I'm running to the end of the time, but The Nonpartisan League was having a meeting and ran into difficulty in Fribourne County. The postmaster in Alden sniffed out this meeting. He knew they were going to have a meeting. He gets a hold of the authorities, and they raid the Nonpartisan League, which is in a schoolhouse in Mansfield Township. Apparently, lots of Germans in that part of the county. They raided it. I mean, anyone heard of the First Amendment here or something? But they seriously did raid it. And it turns out that it was kind of a lot of nothing. Instead of getting too rough, they all just took off a collection for the Red Cross, and everybody went home. There was one, to tell you how absurd this stuff is, there was a campaign rally for Lindbergh, which I believe was to be held in Martin County, which was raided. And so the Lindbergh campaign rally moved across the border and had their rally for Minnesota governor in Iowa. Serious. That's and there are many incidents of this. If you start reading the books, and I love to read that stuff, but the way it went. Dissent, not tolerated. That's what it looks like, you've been tarred and feathered. That fellow was from Laverne. He'd been run out of Minnesota once, but he came home to help his son in the summer of 1918. I believe we were going to thresh. And he got caught again, so they tarred and feathered him and threw him across the border into South Dakota. And by the way, at the end of the war, he sued those people, and he lost. The jury wouldn't find the people who did it guilty. So scary, but nevertheless happened. Boozy Prairie. I'm not going to spend huge amounts of time there, but the Public Safety Commission had its hands full with Blooming Prairie. Four saloon owners, a large Irish population, and by the way, I know some of the family of these saloon owners, and they will tell you, Grandpa just had to make a living. It was his living for many years, and now all of a sudden, they're trying to tell me and all that sort of thing. And so the Austin Herald was especially hard on them. There's one article that says in the Herald, so-and-so got off the train in Austin from Blooming Prairie, and he dropped his bag, and the bottles broke, and for a while, the train station smelled like Blooming Prairie. You know, why would a paper say that? But they did, and it is worth a smile these days, but in those days, it wasn't. That was one of those... One of those saloon owners got caught in, I believe it was in the area of Northwood or Manly. You know those railroad hand pump rail cars? He loaded his car with whiskey, and he'd driven down there, and he loaded this car with whiskey bottles, and he was going to sneak into Mason City in the middle of the night because Mason City was dry, and he got caught. But again, sort of worth a smile now, not so much in those days. Lots of court cases, the Home Guard, which took place of the National Guard when the National Guard was recalled or called up, invaded Blooming Prairie more or less, trying to stop the trade in liquor. It was very difficult. I'll close with, I talk too much, but I'll close with the other huge problem that occurred during the war, at the very end of the war, and that was influenza. I found this, to my surprise, in the Blooming Prairie Times. And you'll see in the right column that Edwin Jolson returned Sunday from camp in Virginia. He'd been in a training camp. He's hale and hearty. He was met at the train, and you'll see in the left-hand column his younger brother, who was 24 at the time, passed away from influenza. Can you imagine your parents meeting at the train and saying, the funeral for Hans was yesterday, and really tough stuff. So the newspapers, you see a lot of that sort of thing. And besides coping, my argument is, my contention, you know, it's not like rocket science, but by October 1918, America's at the Meuse-Argonne, which is the biggest battle even to this day America's ever get involved in terms of numbers of soldiers. Every newspaper, the headlines are screaming about the war in France. And then you got to worry about the children you have at home. Are they going to die of the flu? And things must have been really miserable at that time in our history, whether it's Albert Lee or wherever it might be. These young men were from a farm by Geneva, and full disclosure, I've heard this story before because Edwin Jolson was my grandpa. He was the one who came home. But you can imagine the surprise when I was reading the newspaper and I saw these two side by side. Influenza was deadly, killed more soldiers than bullets did. But life went on. Chautauqua, fairs, churches, schools, all of that sort of thing. Not maybe the Academy Award quality of movies, but certain propaganda sorts of things. I'll close with this. With this is my favorite one of all of these. A few years ago, the Moore County Historical Society was given a bunch of letters belonging to a former mayor of Austin called George Hirsch. George Hirsch's son, Alex. Any of you ever hear of Hershey's Clothing in Austin? Okay, that's where it is. But at any rate, George Hirsch was mayor at the time. His son was a lieutenant in the Army. And the thing that he's talking about, you'll note that the date on it is November 12th, 1918. And when the word came down, I love this phrase, Austin went wild. Albert Lee did too, but this is put in print. And by the way, Albert Lee, June 5th, when everyone had to register, if you were in Austin, you went and registered, and that was your duty. If you went in Owatonna, you went and registered, but they were a little worried about anti-draft feelings there, so you were admonished, don't dawdle in front of the registration building. Go home. Behave yourself. Albert Lee had a party. If you were to look at the Fremont County Standard for June, reporting on the events of June 5th, parades, orations, food, people, marching bands, and everything, honored the registrants of that day, of June 5th, 1918. It's kind of fun to read. Okay, that the war's over. That concludes. This is a nice view of the Blooming Prairie Times. Democracy won. Victory, peace, and safety. Well, we keep having to fight for those same things, don't we? But at any rate, that's what I have to say, and I know I took a lot of time. So questions or comments? I will say, it's not my purpose here to be a salesman, but if you are interested, I have a few copies of my book for sale. Okay, I'm happy to take any questions from anyone who...